slow to anger. Your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord.
Well, good morning, everybody. You like to stand up with us and start in worship. We've got the Solid Rock. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, and his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Well, Heavenly Father, we just come to you this morning, God, and we give you glory and praise, God, for who you are and what you've done. We thank you for the privilege it is to come here and worship you and to learn about your word, Father, and fellowship with like-minded believers. We just pray that you fill us with your spirit, God, and that we can, as we leave this place today, we could have grown and become more mature in Christ, and that we can see you in just a more exalted way, Father, because you deserve it. And we just give you glory again and praise. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Cross our way to freedom, the cross our wrath to bear. But God, so rich in mercy, and took our place and saved us there. Lift him high, all praise to Jesus.
I lift him high for all to see. I lift him high, the cross of Calvary, where mercy died to set us free. Well, our King who reigns victorious now sits upon his throne. Forever he is worshipped, and glory to our God alone. We lift him high, all praise to Jesus, and lift him high for all to see. And lift him high, the cross of Calvary, where mercy died to set us free. Now all the saints adore you, heaven bows before you, worthy is the great I am. All the saints adore you, heaven bows before you, worthy is the great I am.
We're going to sing that again.
We say all the saints adore you, heaven bows before you, worthy is the great I am. Yeah, all the saints adore you, heaven bows before you, worthy is the great I am. We lift him high, all praise to Jesus. We lift him high for all to see. Lift him high, the cross of Calvary, where mercy died to set us free. We lift him high, all praise to Jesus. Lift him high for all to see. We lift him high, the cross of Calvary, where mercy died to set us free.
Amen. Praise God. Well, let's take a moment and greet a neighbor today.
The eyes of my heart. We say, open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Oh, won't you open the eyes of my heart, Lord? Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Yes, I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Oh, won't you open the eyes of my heart? I want to see you. Yes, I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Yeah, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Yes, I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Oh, pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. We sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. And you are holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
Let's sing that again.
We sing holy, holy, holy. We cry holy, holy, holy. Well, you are holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Because you are holy, holy. And there is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. Oh, it sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Whoa, oh.
Jesus, so
because he first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Yes, so
feels so good to sing his praises. Praise God. You guys sound lovely out there.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise you could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you, Lord. You're holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show. Your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Jesus.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you, Lord. 'Cause you're holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show.
I will build my life.
Yes, I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will trust. is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Good morning. Hey guys, we got some announcements, but first, before we start, if you don't have a Bible, we would encourage you to get one. We have somebody that will hand you one. We want to be like Bereans in Acts. Make sure you can read the word as it's being taught to you. Okay, first announcement is we are having our monthly potluck next Sunday after second service. The food this week or next week is going to be spaghetti and lasagna. So if you'd like to bring a side dish, we encourage that. We have flyers out on the information table for us. Second announcement is men's fellowship breakfast. We want to let you know that the men's fellowship breakfast has had some changes. Starting Saturday, November 12th, the men's fellowship breakfast was going to be meeting upstairs at Ryder's Restaurant, located over on F Street, 875 East F, to be precise. The other change that's going to be happening, you guys will probably be more happy about, is it's going to be at 7 a.m. instead of 6:30 a.m. So it'll run through to about 8:30. Again, we have flyers at the information table for you have. Tonight's prayer night has been canceled. Pastor Jeff is sending his greetings from India. He wants you to know that he's praying for us all as he's there and is looking forward to being back with us next week. He appreciates our continued prayer as he's going to be there until Friday. So please continue to lift him up. Today, we are pleased to have a good friend of our ministry, Pastor Garth, here to share a word with us. So please give me a warm welcome to have Pastor Garth with us.
Good morning. Good to be together. You can just remain standing. We'll turn to our passage in a moment. That way you don't have to sit down and get back up again. But yes, we'll be praying for, your pastor. We love Jeff and April. My wife and I have had the privilege of serving together on staff at Calvary Chapel Modesto years ago. We just love them. Thankful that he gets a chance to go out and visit churches around the world and to be in India and have your eyes open to the blessings that we have here, but also a reminder that the church is being persecuted all over the earth, and we're blessed today. So if you have your Bibles with you, turn with me to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. If you don't have a Bible, I would get a Bible, because you just kind of want to look on the page at these words. They're given from God. They're eternal, but wow, the things that God tells us. And we're blessed to know those truths. We take them for granted. If you're raised in church and you've known the Bible for a long time, you think everybody knows those basic truths of life, right? Of love, of salvation, of eternity. And then the bonus part is God gives us all of the countdown and the leading up to the end of this age and the beginning of the new age, which is the second coming of the Lord. And we get all of that written on a page, and the world is left out of that without Christ. And so the Lord's going to come back and rule and reign forever. So let me read the text, and 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, we ask you not to be so soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first. And the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing, proclaiming himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things, and now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth, that they might be saved. For this reason, God will send them strong delusion, that they should believe the lie, and that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Well, that's a list. Lord, we thank you this morning for the opportunity to just let your word wash over our hearts. It's amazing that you speak so clearly and bluntly, Lord, about the days ahead and what's coming and your plans and Satan himself as a warning to us. And Lord, this morning we know that we're privileged greatly to hear this truth and to know this truth, because there's a whole world out there who doesn't know it, and they're in darkness and blind. And so, Lord, would you just refresh our hearts, remind us of these important truths, Lord, and encourage us today, Lord, for the day we live in, and to live and to be bold for you. We love you today. We thank you for loving us. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. So, most people in the world today, if we understand this, we realize this, they can only wonder where the world is heading. Can you imagine just kind of wondering, like, I wonder what's going to happen in the world? Many are fearful, terrified. They're looking at America, for those of us that are here, unraveling and watching Russia and China and Iran and other nations seeking to be have world dominance. And you're just wondering who's going to win that battle. Wondering if World War III is right around the corner, on the horizon. The world, the lost world, right, senses that there's something coming. I think everybody thinks there's something coming. It's in the air, isn't it? That we're at a turning point, but they don't know where it's going to go, possibly the end. Or some that are, you know, hopeful to think that maybe there's a new beginning or a new age that might come to man. But they're in the dark, aren't they? And they don't have a clue what's on the horizon. One commentator said this. He said, the world is on fire, and who can put it out? Wow. I wouldn't want to be in that camp. And as believers, we sure don't need to be, do we? It makes sense that the world is in the dark, because that's what Satan does. He keeps people in the dark, and for good reason, because It's not going to. He doesn't want to tip the hand that it's him who's coming, and he is going to come to this earth as this passage says, and he's working, and he's waiting for his time. But sadly, it gets a little bit worse. This is kind of the heart that I have for this particular message. I shared it in a broader sense on a Wednesday night for you here a long time ago, but. My concern is for the church. That's what I think of when I look at this passage here, because this church is being manipulated by false teachers. And they put out a word here. It's a reason for this letter. It's only three chapters long. And this middle chapter is really the heart of why Paul writes it. And they have been deceived by false teachers, and somebody has told them that they are in the day of the Lord. And they know what that means. That means that they're in the tribulation time that the Old Testament speaks about so clearly. And they're terrified, but it's a lie. And they thought that it came from the apostles or from Paul, but it didn't. And Paul has to write and say, whoa, 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 wait a minute. Let's back up, and let's go back over what you've been taught and remind you that this cannot be. And so that's the purpose of the passage. But when I think today of the church, much of the church echoes the same blind ignorance of the end times. You're blessed to be in a church that takes the Bible literally and walks through the Bible as it unfolds, and Bible prophecy is open to you because you understand those passages. The book of Revelation is something that your pastor doesn't shy away from. No, it's a clear message of where the world's heading and what's coming. Do you know there are broad, many denominations, movements, churches, I mean, scores of them across the earth that do not even believe that there's a tribulation coming, or that there's a bodily return of Christ to rule and reign on the earth for 1,000 years. You say, well, how could that be? The Bible's so clear about that. I know, but it's a mystery to the rest of the church, and they're in ignorance over it. Can you imagine the fear that would come upon you when you don't know what's going to happen today or what's going to happen with the earth? They're just told, well, the Lord's going to return someday. And then clean the whole earth as one kind of, you know, magic wand here. But it's not going to go down that way, is it? They don't know what's coming, so many in the church, and they don't even care to know, which is even part of it as well, what's coming. There's a reason why God's told us what's coming, because we need to know what's coming. And Paul said, I'm going to write a whole book here, a whole letter again to you, so that you would be reminded of what's coming. It's important for us, and I think this morning we'll see that. Verse 1, it says, now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, and he begins to explain from there. The Bible speaks of two things here, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him. There's some events that the Bible speaks about pretty clearly in the New Testament, echoing the Old Testament, and that is the coming of our Lord. It says the coming of our Lord and our gathering together to him. Paul had just written a letter to them before this. They're a young church. In fact, he only got to spend a month with them starting this church. And now, later on, he wrote back to them explaining some more of the things that he had taught them. But in 1 month, he had taught them an amazing amount of Bible prophecy. And then he wrote back to them to confirm with them what they were taught. And so this coming of the Lord to them meant the coming of the Lord in the air. They understood it very clearly. Because of his first letter, he knew what that meant, the coming of the Lord. And then our going up to him. You say, well, what is that? Well, that's the first book, 1 Thessalonians. You can flip a couple pages back if you want, but many of you know this passage. But he says, for this we say to you, by the word of the Lord, 1 Thessalonians 4:15, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will go upwards, right? They'll rise first, and then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him. So that's good news, isn't it? So, I mean, there's a time when the Lord's going to leave the throne of God. He's going to step out. He's going to come into the air. And there's a group of people, it says, believers are going to rise to be with him and to be with him in the air. It says, and we shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Hey, that's good news. That's good news, especially when we think of what's coming after that. The Lord is coming in the air. That's something that we need to understand because the Bible is very clear about it, because he's not going to make his church go through what's coming next. But that's what this church thought had happened. He says in verse 2, they're troubled because somebody has told them that the day of the Lord has begun. So look in verse 2, it says the day of the Lord. Well, that's different. It's a different thing altogether in the Bible. In fact, in the Old Testament, it's called out by that same name, the day of the Lord, many, many, many times. And the sad part about it is that it's really not a great day. It was a day of dread and a day of fear. 1 Thessalonians 5, Paul has already wrote to them about this. He says, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. It's going to come upon this earth very quickly, isn't it? While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them. Not on us, but on them. Suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. They is the key word here, as he uses it, and we'll see that in the... There's a difference between us and them. It's sad to be the them, but they will suffer greatly at the coming of the Lord. Daniel speaks of this same day of the Lord as a seven-year period, and it's the 70th seven in Daniel chapter 9, and he says very clearly that for 1-7 there will be this time where, again, Satan will have free reign here in his deception over the earth. And so the coming of the Lord is good news. Is for us, is we're going to meet the Lord in the air. But the day of the Lord, that's bad news. And so for this church, it was bad news. I can't believe that we're in the day of the Lord. What happened? And so he's correcting this for them. You say, well, how bad could that be? I mean, you know, there's... Could it really be that bad if we went through, you know, the church went through this 7 years? And, well, let me just remind you what Jesus said. He said, there's never been anything as bad as this of what's coming here. The earth has never seen anything that bad, nor will it ever see anything that bad again. That's how bad it is. You say, wow, that's pretty bad. How do you describe it? Well, let me just try to describe it to you. It's in Isaiah 13, 16 through 6 through 13, and this is just one of the passages that speaks about the day of the Lord. And it says, wail. And this is speaking of Israel, because they are going to be a part of the day of the Lord, because they haven't, as a nation, turned to Jesus. Part of the day of the Lord is for them to repent in this, it's called the time of Jacob's trouble for them. So it's not speaking of the church here, but speaking to them, it says, wail. For the day of the Lord is near. It will come like destruction, sounds familiar for what we just read, from the Almighty. That's who it comes from. Because of this, all hands will go limp. Ever been so afraid you just couldn't hardly move? Every man's heart will melt. That's terror. Terror will seize them. Pain and anguish will grip them. They will writhe like a woman in labor. You see, could that be coming to this earth? Yeah, it is. They will look aghast at each other, their faces aflame. See, the day of the Lord is coming, a cruel day with wrath and fierce anger to make the land desolate and destroy the sinners within it. The stars of heaven and their constellations will not show their light. The rising sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. I will punish the world for its evil, the wicked for their sins. I will put an end to the arrogance of the haughty and will humble the pride of the ruthless. Wow. I mean, does that even ring a bell to us in our hearts of what we're seeing on the earth? It's like and this passage speaks of it that we're reading today, speaks of it as lawlessness. It's just like any possible evil that you can do, the world is running toward it. It's as if complete rejection of God is filling the hearts of people all over the earth, and they're just completely in defiance of God. And with that, they're falling into the clutches of the evil that Satan is all about. This is very clear. Satan is very good at what he does, and that's called deception, but it leads to darkness and pain and misery. And God says, listen, I'm not letting that go forever. So it's kind of hard to believe that the one bringing all this is God. And the Bible says specifically it's Jesus. He's going to unloose the scrolls, and he's going to unleash this. Why? It's a last attempt for man to be so uncomfortable in their wickedness and in pain over their sin that they turn from it and accept the love of God. It isn't God's hatred for man. He loves man. But the earth will be put into a vice there, and they'll have an opportunity to turn there. But the Bible says most will not, but some will, and there'll be a great harvest in that day. And part of that will be Israel, but this passage really isn't about Israel. Verse 3, it says, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day, right, will not come unless the falling away comes first and the man of sin is revealed. So it says that you're going to, if you were in that day, then you would know, you would have seen two things. The first thing you would see is the falling away. And that's what I'm talking about today. We're seeing a falling away. Now, that isn't of true believers. The Bible says a true believer is not going to be deceived. The elect are not going to be deceived. That's not possible because we have the Holy Spirit in our heart. But I'm talking about those who go to church, those who are part of religion, and there's a lot of things that say Christian and have their name to it. But we're going to see a great a time of apostasy. That's called a revolt or departure. We've already seen it in our time. A lot of denominations and movements are just going into wickedness and ordaining it, right? And so we're seeing that move away. Why? Because they're being absorbed by this culture of these last days, right? Wickedness and lawlessness that's there, and it breaks the heart of God. It's a rebellion, and it's also going to come from within the church. And there's a departure, and I believe it's already begun, and we've seen it in the last generation, but for sure in the last 10 years, it's been amazing how fast we've seen churches drop away. And it always starts with the Word of God not being in there, not being perfect, not being true. And so they get to reinterpret it, and it's sad. He says, let no one deceive you in any way. He doesn't want anyone to be deceived. That day will not come unless this happens. And so 2 Timothy 4, 3 and 4 says, for the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears, and they'll accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passage. You can just dial away on your TV, right? If you got a whole list of them, and they're all promising this, promising that, filling your ears with, whatever it is. It says, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. And that's what they were leading this church into, a myth that the church is going to go through the tribulation. It's not going to go through the tribulation. It's a great promise that we have that we're not going to suffer the wrath of God. The day of the Lord, the church, they'll say the church is going to lead the world into a millennial peace in Christianity. Things are going to get better and better and better. No, they're not going to get better and better. The Bible says it's going to get darker and darker, and the Lord's going to have to take us out of here. And so you're missing this, and you're not understanding it. And the statistics on churches that don't understand even the simplest things about the biblical worldview, Bible says only 9% of those who profess faith, Christian in whatever organization, movement, you know, denomination around the world, even understand their own biblical worldview. They don't understand the Bible. And only half of Protestant pastors have a correct biblical worldview, and that's those who actually read the Bible, study the Bible, and teach the Bible is true. It's like an I don't know if it's the right word, but it's an illiteration. We're becoming illiterate, Bible illiterate. And Paul says, listen, let's get back up to speed here. We need to catch you up because you need to remember what we said was true, and that is not true what they're saying. And I'm going to prove it to you. And he's going to prove it to them. And he says the man of sin is going to be revealed. And the Bible says if you haven't seen him, then you're not in it. So that's an easy way to know you're not in the tribulation because you don't know the man of sin. Who's the man of sin? He's the Antichrist. He's a man that the world has not yet seen. He's a man indwelt by Satan. And he will be one of the most deceptive men to ever, you know, be on the earth, and Satan will be behind him. And Daniel again says he, this Antichrist, will confirm a covenant with many for 1:7. He says he's going to actually make a covenant with Israel for peace and safety, a 7-year covenant, and he'll burst onto the world stage, and he will be revealed. And that's the beginning of the 7 years. So if you haven't seen that, you don't know who he is, and we don't know who he is, and the world hasn't been revealed of that. That means we're not in the tribulation, as some churches might say that we are, or that we're in the millennium. A lot of other churches say that we're in the millennium. No, that's a ways out. But what will the Antichrist bring to this world? What's he going to bring? He's going to bring great, great, great deception. He's not only going to turn people away from God, he's going to say that he is God. He's going to appear as God. Verse 4 says, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God. He can make wickedness look godly. And he can make right look wrong and wrong look right. And for a brain that is lost and in darkness, and all of our hearts and minds are lost without Christ, who renews our hearts and renews our minds in the truth, he can do anything he wants and twist this world up into a pretzel. And the Bible says he's going to be released to do that. That is called God, or that is worship, so that he sits as God in the temple of God. He's even going to deceive Israel into thinking that he's their Messiah. And they're going to prepare to worship him as their Messiah. And then their eyes are going to be open when he defiles the temple. And that's the second half of the tribulation, which, by the way, gets worse than the first part. And so, have we seen the man of sin? And he's saying that to this church as well. No, you have not. Why? Because you cannot see him. You will not see him. You're not going to see him. He's sure of that. How can he be so sure of that? He says, Paul knows that they hadn't seen him because, again, they weren't going to see him. And why? Because he knows that they're going to be gone before he comes on the scene. Why? Because that's what the Bible teaches us, that we're going to be out of here before then. Verse 5, he says, do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? So it's a reminder that they've already been told these things. He's reminding them of what they've been told. Nice to know that a church that's so young, a month old, already knows all these things. And we have churches that are, you know, 100 years old, 50 years old, that people don't know any of those things. But Paul said, listen, it's important that you know, because when you're under persecution, you're under travail, you need to know that the Lord's coming for us. We're going to rise to be with the Lord, and that encouragement. Then evil isn't going to win, and Satan's not going to overwhelm the church either, which is important. And we need to know that. Jesus, Don't remember that when I was with you, I told you these things. And again, as this young church, they were pretty wise. I enjoy going into Calvary chapels. That's why I was a part of the Calvary's for so many years, is because they teach the Bible. I remember going into the church. I've been raised in another denomination, and it did love the Bible, and it held to good doctrines, but it just didn't teach the Bible. And I remember sitting in the first Sunday night service, and a pastor getting up and opening the Bible and going through three chapters, and I was stunned. I've been going to church, I mean, 2-3 times a week for my whole life, pretty much. And I'm just sitting there going, what in the world? A church where you open your Bible and you read it and he explains it. Unbelievable to me, just literally stunned. And I just sat there with my wife and I just said, why doesn't every church do this? Why don't people know their Bibles? I had been, you know, in church for many, many years, didn't know the whole counsel of God. I knew passages, I knew stories, I knew all of that. But that's how you know it. You have a love for the truth, and he's going to remind us of that. The church should expect to escape the wrath of the Lord. He's going to rapture us out. So if you want to go back and do a Sunday afternoon study, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 culminates in the end with comfort one another with these words. It's good news. We're going up. But chapter 5 is bad news. And when he comes into there, he speaks about they, and they're going to face this. They're going to face sudden destruction. And what he reminds them in that, as he did at the beginning of the letter, he says, and wait for his, for us, we wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. Reminds us that we're thankful that we're out of here, and he's going to take us away. Again, 80% of the church doesn't even believe that day is coming, that there is a rapture of the church in that way to escape what's the worst thing, worse than that, that's coming on the earth. Verse 8, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. Aren't you glad that the Lord wins? And he's just saying, listen, he is coming, and it's going to be horrible, and but the Lord's going to win. I skipped a little section here. I want to go back here. Let me ask you a question. What's stopping Satan from raising up the Antichrist today? Why aren't we already there? I mean, if Satan's going to enter this guy and the whole world's going to be deceived, why haven't we already been deceived? Why is Satan waiting so long for this? Verse 6, it says, and now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Satan is already working in this age, and he has been even in Paul's time, but not like he's going to. It says, only he who now restrains, whoever the person is, it's a he, okay? And he will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed. So who is the he? People, there's some debate over that, but there's only one answer that can be true. It's the Holy Spirit of God. See, the Bible says that we are the church, and Jesus says, I'm leaving you, but I'm sending a comforter to come to you, and he will be with you. He will be in you. So the church, when you describe the church, it's the only place on the planet where the Holy Spirit dwells. Doesn't mean the Holy Spirit isn't everywhere. God is everywhere. He knows everything. But literally, his indwelling is within the church, and it is the church that's supposed to be the light for Christ. So if we think about that, God has established this, that it is the church. Now, what would cause the restraint to go out of the earth? What if the church was taken out of the earth? It's exactly what's going to happen. He's going to take that church. That restraint is gone. Can you imagine how dark it's going to be when the church is not in this earth? All there will be are lost people on this earth. How dark will that light be when the light goes out? And so that's what he's speaking about and reminding them of that as well, because they know they're indwelt by the Holy Spirit. So that restraint is going to be lifted. And important lessons here for that. When the church is taken out of the world and the restraint is removed, what's going to fill the vacuum? Evil. The good news is that obviously this is on the Lord's timing, because until the Lord takes it out, Satan can't do anything. He can't overwhelm the church. He can't overwhelm the Holy Spirit. And so He's not on his own timetable. He's on God's timetable. And so God decided, now when's the rapture going to take place? Well, we don't know that either. Only God knows that. So it's all on his timetable. When he says the word, the Lord's going to come, grab his church, and off we go. But it is, praise the Lord, the day of the Lord cannot even begin until that restraint is removed. And so Satan, thank God, isn't in control. He's going to be allowed to deceive others. And so verse 8, then the lost one will be revealed, and the Lord is going to consume him. Last part of this study here, verse 9 through 12. Wow, Satan is, we're going to see it, that the Antichrist here is Satan himself. Verse 9, the coming of the lawless one is in accordance with the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders. You say, well, I wouldn't fall for that. Yeah, you would. If it wasn't for the truth of God that we hold and know through the Spirit of God who has revealed that to us, you look and you say, how can the world be so crazy? Why is it that their mind can't even process the simplest things in our culture? It's like, don't you know that's going to lead to destruction if you head that direction? But they don't know because they're lost and they're blind, and that should give us compassion, right? For people to come to the light and to the truth. But he's powerful. He's really good at what he does. I hate Satan. I hate him. You say, well, you're not supposed to hate anyone. Well, the Bible says you're supposed to hate evil. And he's pure evil. There's no good in him. There's no light in him. There's no turning in him. He completely hates God and hates us and does not want anybody on this earth to come to God. That's his ultimate mission, and he's really good at it. And he's going to produce signs and lying wonders that the world will just gobble up and to follow him. Why? He explains it here. Very interesting. He says, with all unrighteous deception. Lawlessness itself is pretty interesting, but unrighteous deception, he's good at that. He can deceive people into doing everything that is unrighteous, not right, among those who perish. Now, be careful to read carefully. Look at the text with me. You say, God's gonna allow them to be deceived? He says, with all unrighteous deception among those who perish because they did not receive the love of the truth. It's explained very often, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish. The Spirit of God is calling people, speaking to them to turn to God, receive the love of God, the grace of God, and of course with the gospel of God going out as well. But that's been rejected. We'll see why in a moment. They didn't receive the love of the truth. Of course, the world doesn't love the truth. But the church should love the truth, right? And I speak in a broad sense. That it says that they might be saved. He's not speaking to his church. He's saying they, that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion. That they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth. Truth is amazing, but you can accept it or you can reject it. But had pleasure in unrighteousness. Let me just close with a couple of things today. Why would Paul, what it means so much to Paul to say, listen, I got to correct this. This is going to be devastating. What does it really matter what the church believes in eschatology, whether we're already in the tribulation or going in the millennium, or what does it really matter? You know, that's just doctrine. Church doesn't really, yeah, that shouldn't get hung up on that. It's nothing to do with salvation. No, it was very important. Why? Because it shook them to the core. Because they knew what the Word of God taught about this day of the Lord, and it meant a lot. And so, number one, the Lord gives us prophecy today. Why do we have it? Why does he want us to know it? He wants all the church to know it. If we were in Paul's church, within a month, we would have known it. We would have spent quite a few Bible studies going over who the Lord is, what salvation is, that the Lord's going to return, and what's going to happen in this age. So, He didn't want them to be shaken. And he says in verse 2, he says, do not be quickly shaken from your composure or be disturbed. We should be composed, church. Even in these days when we see wickedness beginning to be unleashed in the darkness of this world and where the world is heading, we're composed. We're not shaken because we know this is what's been promised and the Lord's got us, right? Even in the midst of persecution, and they were persecuted pretty greatly even in their day, but you know, your pastors in India where people lose their lives or get taken to prison or they burn their church down or whatever it is for standing with Christ. And he said, listen, I need you to be encouraged, not discouraged. Be encouraged. The Lord's got us, and we're going to go to be with him. And he, you know, evil is not going to win. So one of the purposes of this passage is that they would not be fearful. We as believers have to remember that Jesus is coming to gather us up. We're to be looking up. We're to have our heads up. We don't walk around with our heads down. We walk around with our heads up. We have a great and mighty God, and his promises are real, and he will come and get us. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 says, we don't want you to be ignorant, and that's the important part of it. Verse 5 in your text. Look real quickly. Paul, as he, at the end of verse 5, he says, I told you these things. And the beginning of verse 6 says, and now you know, right? And that's the way that it is. We've been told these things, we've been taught these things, and we should know them. So when anybody, even the church, says anything different, a word or an apostle or somebody, and it defies what we know, then we reject it, don't we? And we put it away, and we can know the truth. Number two, so that we would remain peaceful and comforted in these last days. 1 Thessalonians 4:18 says, therefore, comfort one another with these words. We should be at peace in the middle of the storm. Our hearts should be at peace. Our God has conquered evil. He's conquered death, and he will destroy Satan completely. He's going to annihilate him at the end of the tribulation. It'll never have its reign again on this earth, and good to know that. But it's going to have its day because it's going to be a part of the last days for men to choose. And finally today, that we would continue in the love of the truth. And my prayer for you as a church that God would just give you a heart to continue to love the truth. And when he speaks about it here, that they did not receive the love of the truth. The truth is God's love given to man, that he tells us the truth. Of course, that truth reveals his love for us in his son, Jesus, that he loves this world. He doesn't want any to perish, but that all would come to repentance. But as a church, the Bible calls us to be Bereans, and it says that we should be studying the word of God. Why do they need to be reminded? Because we forget, or we need to be called to attention what we believe and what we know. And it's very valuable, isn't it? What's it worth to you to know all these things? It's worth everything, isn't it? Who would want to live in a world that is that dark? And no hope and not knowing. I mean, you can see why people are pretty just beside themselves. They have no idea what's going to happen on this earth, and they think the sky is falling maybe tomorrow. And they have, of course, there's no control over it. Hey, it's good to know that there's a God who's in control of it. And he loves this world, and he's got us under his wing, and we can be encouraged and strengthened. Let me close with this last passage here. It's in 2 Thessalonians here, verse 13. It says, but we ought to always thank God for you, brothers, loved by the Lord. Because from the beginning, God chose you to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit and through belief in the truth. That's how we're saved. We believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ in his victory. So then, brothers, stand firm and hold the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word or by mouth or by letter. Grab a hold of the word of God and stand on it. May the Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope. He's given us some pretty good hope, hasn't he? and hope's a promise, and it's going to be fulfilled. Encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. And may that hope and encouragement encourage us today. Let me pray. Lord, what a day to be walking with you in this earth. It can rattle us, Lord, as we see this, the unleashing and maybe the untethering of wickedness. Signs of the times. It's already, that lawlessness is already here on the earth. The earth is going berserk and rebellion against you, Father, and the nations are raging. But Lord, we're so glad that you're not losing any sleep, and you got us in your hand, and you've given us precious promises. So would you encourage us today as the church? And would you remind us, Lord, that the light is beautiful and the truth is lovely, and give us a heart to share that with people who are in darkness so that they can come into the marvelous light. And we love you today, and we're glad to worship you and praise you. And if there's anybody here hasn't surrendered their heart and believed on the truth and received your Son, Lord, I pray that they would not leave this building today until they do that. They make you the Lord, and that they can look forward to your coming, the coming of the Lord, and having eternal life. We give you praise and thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Garth. What a wonderful message we heard today. Would you please stand with me and worship the Lord, and let's meditate on the things that we've heard today.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Leaning, leaning, we're leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, we're safe and secure from all alarm. Leaning, leaning, we're leaning on the everlasting arms. And what have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. Well, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms. We're leaning, leaning, we're safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, we're leaning on the everlasting arms.
As Gar said, if you're here today and you need prayer, we're here to do that for you. So don't hesitate, come up front. We'll have somebody here to do that for you. Let's close in prayer. Lord God, just thank you for your word. Thank you for just empowering us. The strength of your word is overwhelming. Lord, let us be those vessels. Let us complete the race, finish it strong, and fight the good fight, Lord. Just give us the ability to continue your work. Lord, just bless us the rest of the week. Be with us and keep us safe. In your precious name, amen. Amen.
A My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Amen. Praise God. God bless you guys. Have a great week. Hopefully we'll see you next week.